Member checking. It's a tool. It's a tool that qualitative researchers can use to help ensure when one is being interviewed that what they said they actually meant. It's a tool because it allows the researcher to take a transcript, a verbatim transcript of the interview, and send it back to the people that were interviewed so that they can each individually read what they said and if there's any areas that need to be changed, because sometimes people will say something when it actually means something else. It's also a philosophy. Not everybody will do member checking. Some people do not believe in the art of member checking. Some would rather just do the interview, take the transcripts, and analyze the data. But I would think that most people, they truly understand about qualitative research and the importance of its accuracy, will apply member checking. It really doesn't take much time, and it is an opportunity for a qualitative researcher to help better ensure that the data they analyze is the correct data based on what each person had to say for each question they were asked. It's not agreed upon concept in many different ways. I will give my approach on how I have my doctoral students apply member checking, which is the same way I do it when I do qualitative research on my own or for my clients. In the sense that it's not agreed upon concept, there's many different variations. I like to have an agreed upon time, which is within 72 hours of the interview, so that when somebody reads the transcript, they'll actually remember the actual interview. The longer you wait, the less likely they're to remember every detail about what they said. So there is this time factor. Some people will not do it in the 72 hours. Some will do it longer. Some may say, well, let's do all the interviews first, then we'll get the transcripts, and then we'll ask for member checking. That may mean that there's several weeks, if not longer, from the time each interview was done to the time when the person actually gets the transcripts to review. To me, that is too long a time. It's still good. It's better than nothing. But member checking, I believe, has a set time frame of how valid it is to be accepted, because the longer you wait, the less likely it is that people are going to take the time to actually review the transcripts. Member checking is applied to help seek to find accuracy and validation. Accuracy first of each individual verbatim transcript. As I mentioned, sometimes in an interview, somebody may be a little stressed out. They may not truly understand the question when asked, and they may give an answer which, upon reflection, would be better off being changed. Member checking allows us the opportunity to help better ensure the accuracy of the data. The more accurate the data, the better the findings are going to be. And it gives the people who are doing the actual review of the transcripts, the people that were actually interviewed, a sense of validation. They can validate what they said is accurate. Helping to ensure this accuracy and validation is a critical point in qualitative research, because when we do interviews, that tends to be the majority of the data that is analyzed in producing findings. We want to make sure that those findings are going to be as accurate as possible. Member checking provides this evidence to support trustworthiness factors. I have a complete different lesson on trustworthiness and the different factors, and two of those factors are credibility and conformability. Credibility as a trustworthiness factor helps to ensure that the data that was actually used is credible by people reviewing the transcripts and confirming that they're accurate and giving their validation allows to increase the credibility of our research when member checking is applied. Conformability means conforming to accepted standards of research. If member checking is not included, that may lessen the trustworthiness of the study because there was no conformability to the best practices of qualitative research. As you look at trustworthiness factors in qualitative research, this is about the equivalent of validity and reliability testing in quantitative research. As you gain more insights and produce more qualitative research, you'll find that doing the extra steps of member checking, as are some of the other steps that are alluded to in this program, such as a field test or expert reviews, they are going to help produce better outcomes. And that's what we want to ensure, that we can produce the best outcome from our research. It's not appropriate for all qualitative research designs. Member checking is ideal for any time people are being interviewed. In many different designs, there's more than just interviews. So there may be no interviews, for example, in any of the other qualitative designs that are used by just looking at different documents, whether they be peer-reviewed or journal articles or newspapers, even stories for some qualitative research where we seek people's stories, there's no need to do member checking. It's applied particularly to those that are being interviewed, such as a case study, phenomenological, and any other design where you're having one-on-one interviews. Determine if member checking is best and appropriate for any qualitative research design you're applying. As an informed consumer of qualitative research, it would be good to know where member checking is valid and applicable and where it's not. Since there are many different approaches to doing member checking, and if you look at different research reports or dissertations that are published about how one did member checking, you're probably going to find some variation. There's nothing wrong with that. I'm going to share with you my approach, and my approach is what I believe serves everybody well. It serves the researcher well, it serves the people who are interviewed well, and it serves the readers of the research once it's published and shared with others. That's really important to me, is to keep in mind the end users of one's research. Yes, I get it, while you're doing research, you're in the midst of it, and maybe you want to get done with it quickly, but quickly isn't always better. And even sometimes more is not better. More efforts doesn't always produce a better outcome. So I want to share my approach with you, and then you can decide what's best for you and your research. If you're a faculty member, perhaps create your own method and make sure that your students adhere to it. Of course, make sure it's sound and systematic and that can be deployed amongst the many different students. If you can find a way that works for you and you can support the actual steps, then I believe you will find that your students will follow your example and your lead. So my approach to doing member checking is that within 72 hours of each individual interview, email the verbatim transcripts. How you get those verbatim transcripts is, of course, is going to be up to you and or your student. Some will use a service, a transcription service. Others will do it themselves. Yet others will hire somebody, perhaps in their family, who's in college, or make their kid do it who's in college. There's no one set way. I encourage you to find somebody who is good at listening to an interview and then typing it. Now, the idea of verbatim is you want literally word for word. There are some transcription services that will give you the general perspective. They won't do word for word. You want word for word. This is going to help increase the accuracy, the validity of your work overall. The verbatim transcripts helps improve the trustworthiness factors of your qualitative research. You might want to take the transcript and have it in a Microsoft Word file. Each interview would be in a separate file and would have information for interview question number 1, number 2, number 3, with all the answers. So you may start on page 1 with the interview transcript from question number 1, and then always start on a new page the next interview question, so that as somebody reads this verbatim transcript, they can just go and recall from the time they were sitting there the order in which everything was asked to them and how they gave their answers. I ask for the interviewees to review for accuracy and validate of what they said and what they meant. This is important, and I think this is the reality of doing member checking, is to make sure what people said they meant. It's not uncommon, as I mentioned earlier in this lesson, that people will say in the transcripts, "I know I said that, but I meant this." And what they meant to say is what you want to use, because that's going to be the more accurate data or information that goes into the analysis work. I ask them to also return within 72 hours of receipt. So if I did the interview on Monday, I would have the opportunity to do the verbatim transcripts and get them back to them within 72 hours. That's basically 3 days. And then I would ask them to do the same, return to me within 72 hours. There's a reason for this. First off, the 72 hours of giving them the transcripts allows some time, but not too much time, for them to do the recall and review the work. If they can't return it within 72 hours, chances are they're probably not going to. You want to put some sense of emergency or priority to the work, because you need to get on with the data analysis. The last thing you want to do is have your last person who you interviewed not return the transcripts for a week, because that's just going to delay your work. So be kind to them and ask them to return it within 72 hours. Now, this is what happens if they do or they don't. If edits are required, and more times than not, there are some edits, even if they're minor. What I suggest, if they provide back already edited, because maybe you sent it to them in an MS Word file and they went in there and they just made the actual changes themselves and sent it back, use that file. They've given you the edits already. Nothing wrong with that. You don't have to go back into it and change it. Whatever they said, you leave it as it is. It's not up to you to evaluate if it was right or wrong, or if they meant to say what they typed or not. Just use what they've given you. If not returned already edited, and they make edits, would say they print it out and they write on the sides of it, or they call you back and say, well, I know I said this in answer to interview question number two, but I meant this, then that's fine. If not returned already edited, then you make the edits and return it to the person for another review and reply within 72 hours again. So you kind of repeat the process. This way, they get a chance to see again if what's now in the revised answer is exactly what they mean. Yes, this can take an extra few days, but in the scheme of things, in doing qualitative research, this time is valuable in helping to ensure the accuracy of your findings. So you send it back to them and ask them to review it one more time, and you repeat the process. If at any time in either of those reviews, no confirmation is received within 72 hours, assume it's correct and use it for data analysis. Don't keep pestering them. You offer them 72 hours to return it to you. If they don't return it to you, that's okay. Don't take it personally. They probably got other things going on in their lives. They've already given you their valuable time for the interview. Don't worry about it. Just in your information, when you send it to them, say, I'm going to give you 72 hours. If I don't get a response from you within 72 hours, I'm going to assume you have no changes, and I'm going to go with what you had. Nothing wrong with that. This is an acceptable practice. You're not expected to chase everybody down and try to get their review of the transcripts. You can try if you want to, but depending on how many people you interview, let's say you interview 20 people, you could be hunting down a lot of responses and trying to get hold of people, and you never will. So don't worry about it. Set the policy that if they don't confirm it in 72 hours, you're going to assume it's accurate and move on. To help reduce the no confirmation, explain the process before and after the actual interview. So before you start your interview, if you're using an interview script, have in there that upon the transcription, you will email to them, or however you're going to give it to them. Maybe they work with you and you can give them a paper copy. That's fine too. However you're going to do it, just explain the full process that you're going to return a verbatim transcript, and you're asking them to review them for accuracy and to validate what they said they meant. The more information you give them, the more likely they are to help you. It's like anything else. If you know the expectation, you're liable to meet that expectation and more than likely exceed it. If you ask them to return it as quickly as possible, but no longer in 72 hours, chances are a good many of those people, as soon as they see the email or they get the transcripts, they'll do it right then and there for you because they want to help you, because you've asked them for your help. For the reflective summary, I'd like to share with you the highlights of this lesson. The first thing I did was give you some insights about what member checking is and why it's important to qualitative research, how it can improve the trustworthiness factors. The trustworthiness factors are areas we look at to help indicate how valid and how correct the outcome will be once all the data is analyzed and produced in findings. I also gave you some information in this lesson how to conduct member checking. I gave you my 72-hour rule. I like to use the verbatim transcripts and get them to the people to review as quickly as possible and get their replies as quickly as possible. I also don't like to wait on people either. I'll let them know that they have 72 hours to review it, and if they do not return anything, even a confirmation, that I am going to assume what they had said is what they meant and move on with it. The idea is not to stretch out how long it takes to do qualitative research and produce its findings. The goal with member checking, like most other options that we have available to qualitative researchers, is to ensure that all the data collected is as accurate as possible, because once we get all the data, we have to synthesize it together. And oftentimes in qualitative research, we're looking for common factors or themes that are generated. We want to make sure that they're the most accurate as possible, so we make recommendations and conclusions for others to use that information, that we have given them the most informative input we possibly can. If you want help with anything related to member checking, or you want to communicate with me, please do so. I have a Facebook group and page. You can find it at Taking the B Out of ABD, which is the name of this program. I also have a website titled takingthebeeoutofabd.com. And in LinkedIn, you're welcome to get LinkedIn with me if you're not. I'm connected to over 14,000 people. Maybe you'll need some help when you want people to interview. I may be able to help you through that connection that I have that might be in the research population you're looking for. I also have a group in LinkedIn. And guess what that's called? Taking the B Out of ABD. So if you're in LinkedIn and not the other social media sites, check me out over there and I will help you, and you can ask questions there as well. If you like what you heard in this lesson or all the other lessons, I hope you enjoyed as well. Please share with your peers. Let me help them. If by chance you do and they put your name down as a referral, I will give you a referral fee. How's that? If you haven't yet, or if you have and you found value in it, share it with your friends. I have this ebook titled Strategies and Tips to Complete a Doctoral Dissertation Program. It's free. I like free. I like to do free as much as possible. And so therefore, I do a lot of different things like the ebook. I also give tips and strategies in the social media. I have videos in YouTube you can look for as well. But inside this specific ebook that's free, you're going to get some tips that I have, which is 26 of those tips to complete your degree without losing your mind. I have 5 reasons why dissertations do not get finished, so you learn what they are so you don't make the same mistakes. I also give you 8 strategies to finish your dissertation. These are strategies that the best of the best students who graduate on time have applied, and I found that common factors that they applied, you can apply, and you can do even better. I have 7 secrets to completing a dissertation that you wish you knew sooner, particularly if you're all but dissertation and you've been enrolled in your program a lot longer than you thought you would. And then I have 7 myths and tips for scholarly writing that you can master easily and therefore produce better work sooner and graduate. I do believe that member checking helps to improve trustworthiness. The more you learn about member checking and all the many different facets of qualitative research, the better and sooner you will be a more informed consumer of qualitative research. I'm Dr. Rich Schuttler. Appreciate that you took the time to listen to this lesson.